Good evening, everyone. Good evening. Happy Good Friday. We're so glad you made it here. We are just excited to observe the incredible sacrifice that our risen Savior Jesus Christ made for us. And you may notice things are a little bit different. We're sitting down. I'm holding a maraca. But we invite you this service. We want to set the atmosphere for a service that is deeply reflective, one that you can really take time to think about what God has done for us. This may be your 50th Good Friday service, or maybe your first, but either way, we want to invite you to really, really deeply reflect on what the Lord has done. Reflect on the sacrifice of Jesus. So in order to do that, to set that up, we're going to have some readings. We are going to sing. We invite you to worship in whichever way is comfortable for you. You can stay seated, you can stand, whatever feels comfortable to you. But our goal is that you experience Good Friday in a way that you haven't before, and that the Lord would speak deeply to your heart. And as we pour out our love on our Father, we would just really experience Him pouring His love out on us. Father God, we just invite you into this service. We ask that you would be lifted up. We ask that you would be magnified. We ask, Lord, that you would speak to each and every heart in this place. Thank you, God, for your sacrifice. Thank you for what you did on the cross, that while we were yet sinners, you died for us. We thank you and we love you. Our first scripture reading comes from Hebrews 2:9. It says, "But we see him who for a little while was made lower than the angels, namely Jesus, crowned with glory and honor because of the suffering of death, so that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone."
Sorrows, Lamb of God, by his own betrayed, the sin of man and wrath of God has been on Jesus laid. So cries out, hallelujah.
precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me. Whom the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. Now my debt is paid, it is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me. Whom the Son
man's fall and the promise of Satan's destruction from Genesis 3. When the woman saw that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. And she also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate. And they heard the sound of the Lord walking in the garden in the cool of the day. The man and his wife hid themselves. But the Lord God called to the man and said to him, "Where are you?" And he said, "I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid, because I was naked, and I hid myself." He said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten of the tree of which I commanded you not to eat?" The man said, "The woman whom you gave to be with me, she gave me fruit of the tree, and I ate." Then the Lord God said to the woman, "What is this that you have done?" The woman said, "The serpent deceived me, and I ate." The Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, cursed are you above all the livestock and above all the beasts of the field. On your belly you shall go, and dust you shall eat all the days of your life. I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and her offspring. And he shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel."
Until it was accomplished, his death. death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom. No love is deeper, no love is wider or stronger than the Father.
The suffering Redeemer is predicted from Isaiah 53 and Exodus 12. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace. And with his wounds, we are healed. All we, like sheep, have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Then Moses called all the elders of Israel and said to them, "Go and select lambs for yourselves according to your clans, and kill the Passover lamb. Take hyssop and dip it into the blood that is in the basin, and touch the lintel and the two doorposts with the blood that is in the basin. None of you shall go out of the door of his house until morning, for the Lord will pass through to strike the Egyptians. And when he sees the blood on the lintel and on the doorposts, the Lord will pass over the door and will not allow the destroyer to enter your house to strike you." John the Baptist's testimony from John 1:29. The next day, John saw Jesus coming toward him and said, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world."
All my words fall short. I got nothing new. How could I express all my gratitude? I could sing these songs like I often do. Every song must end.
You again and again, 'cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but I've nothing else fit for a king except for a heart singing hallelujah. Hallelujah.
just one move, with my arms stretched wide, I will worship you. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again. 'Cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but I've nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing.
Luke chapter 23, verses 32 through 49. Two others who were criminals were led away to be put to death with him. And when they came to the place that is called the Skull, there they crucified him and the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. And Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." And they cast lots to divide his garments, and the people stood by watching. But the rulers scoffed at him, saying, "He saved others. Let him save himself, if he is the Christ of God, his chosen one." The soldiers also mocked him, coming up, offering him sour wine, and saying, "If you are the King of Jews, save yourself." There was also an inscription over him, "This is the King of Jews." One of the criminals who were hanged railed at him, saying, "Are you not Christ? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we are receiving the due reward of our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." And he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And he said to him, "Truly I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise." It was now about the sixth hour, and there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour, while the sun's light failed, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Then Jesus, calling out in a loud voice, said, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." And having said this, he breathed his last. Now when the centurion saw what had taken place, he praised God, saying, "Certainly this man was innocent." And all the crowds that had assembled for this spectacle, when they saw what had taken place, returned home beating their breasts. And all his acquaintances and the woman who followed him from the Galilee stood at a distance watching these things.
Good evening, church. Happy Good Friday to you. My name is Elise. I'm one of the associate pastors here, and I'm so glad that you're here with us to worship tonight on this amazing night of sacrifice. Amen. You know, there are two types of days. Days that you want to forget ever happened, and days that you want to remember for as long as your memory will allow you to. Several years ago, inspired by the memorial stones that we read about in Joshua chapter 4, when God commanded the Israelites to set up stones while he parted the Jordan River, our family started collecting our own stones to remember what God's done. And we put them in this jar. We write down all the answered prayers, the miracles that we've experienced or that some of our friends and family have experienced. And every once in a while, we'll go through those together and read them again so that we don't forget about all the things that God has done for us. These stones have really become the mile markers for our life. Even when we look around at our city, we'll find all kinds of monuments and museums and memorials that point us to our nation's history, and they plead with us, never forget. And in Christianity, Good Friday is one of those days that you never want to forget. Because this day in history and the events that came after it have become the bedrock for our faith. They're the foundation that we as believers put all of our hope in. Yes. When we moved into our home, I wanted to try to be a plant mom because having four kids, I guess, just wasn't enough for me. So I bought my first plant for our living room, and really it's more like a tree. It's called a corn plant. And the first couple months, I was so excited because it was actually growing. The leaves were green. I mean, it looked beautiful. So after a few months of flourishing, I figured out I could start easing up my attentiveness and maybe just water it once a week. And then once a week became once a month. And then once a month became a couple times every couple of months. And, you know, the leaves were still green and thriving and healthy. So I thought, you know, I'm just going to keep on with this routine. And one thing led to another, and I just completely forgot about it. Just forgot that it was sitting in the corner of our living room, didn't water it at all for months and months. Fast forward to this week, I looked at it and noticed that some of the leaves are brown. A lot of the leaves are brown, and they're falling off on the floor. And I noticed that this wasn't something that happened overnight, but it was a slow and steady process. It stopped thriving because I forgot about it, and then I kept forgetting about it. And even though we observe significant days like Christmas and Good Friday as believers, throughout the years, it's also possible to gradually forget the significance that Jesus' death has had on our life today. Responsibilities at work, maybe parenting, or just simply the busyness of living in this area that we do, it may cloud your vision, and you may get distracted by all that's happening around you. Your focus on what Jesus has done and how it influences your life might take a back seat to the seemingly other important things that are pressing us and going on. And one day, all of a sudden, you notice that you've stopped growing. Tonight, as we close out our Holy Week fast together, let's resist the temptation to breeze past this moment. Let's not clock out. Let's sit in the awkward silence, so to speak. I want us to slow down and reflect on this question tonight. What do you need to remember about Jesus' death? What do you need to remember about Jesus' death? The title of my message tonight is Never Forget, Living in Light of the Cross. Let's pray. Jesus, we are here tonight to honor you, to worship you, to remember the sacrifice that you made for us on the cross. Holy Spirit, we don't want this to be just another day on the calendar. But God, we are sitting here and waiting here for you, expectant that you are going to move through our hearts and transform us. So God, we surrender ourselves to you tonight freshly and ask that you would be with us, that you would speak to us, that you would open our ears to hear your voice. In Jesus' name, amen. Jesus' life is worthy of marveling at, right? It's worthy of marveling at. But the final hours of his life are especially remarkable. For those of you that are new to Christianity or maybe just in church for the first time tonight, this night, Good Friday, marks the betrayal, the arrest, and the crucifixion of Jesus. And to give a brief overview in Luke's account that Danielle just read, we read about an angry mob, including chief priests and Jewish religious leaders, that were convinced that Jesus was guilty of blasphemy. And toward the end of Jesus' life, these religious leaders had developed such a hatred toward Jesus and his followers that they devised a plan to have him killed. So they pay one of Jesus' disciples, Judas, 30 pieces of silver to reveal his whereabouts, and then they detain him and bring him to the governor of Rome, Pontius Pilate. And Pilate, not convinced that Jesus had done anything wrong, says this in verse 22. What evil has he done? I have found in him no guilt deserving death. And although Pilate refused to kill Jesus, he eventually released him to the crowd, but only after having him brutally beaten and tortured. But this wasn't just any beating. The soldiers used a whip designed specifically to inflict excruciating pain. The whip was embedded with pieces of metal and bone, and it actually ripped off the flesh of a person's back when it was released. This punishment alone could have killed him. And after he was tortured, spat on, mocked by soldiers, physically worn down, he was then led to Golgotha. And it was at this desolate place just outside of Jerusalem where Jesus' death would come about by crucifixion. Now, I know that we think about that word crucifixion a lot as believers. We hear it a lot. We know what that is. But when you really think about it, it was an ancient capital punishment used by Rome and other cities that was considered to be one of the most brutally agonizing and inhumane forms of execution. And as life slowly left Jesus' body as he hung on the cross, he says three things that we cannot afford to forget. First, in verse 34, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. At this moment, as people are mocking and yelling out accusations, Jesus' hands had already been pierced and nailed securely to the horizontal beam of the cross. Hanging there, losing against gravity, his feet, which were laid one on top of the other, were nailed down too. Excruciating pain coursed through his body as a combination of lacerations from the scourging, chest pressure from collapsed lungs, and exhausted muscles from the stress of it all simultaneously overwhelmed his body. And yet, even in this fragile state, he doesn't yell back at the crowds who are yelling at him. He doesn't tell them how wrong they are and how right he is. Instead, he chooses to make a public plea to the Father to forgive those who were still mocking him and had put him there to die, to intercede on behalf of the sinners and the future sinners of the world, you and me. Yes. He says, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. Wow. Jesus' words here remind us that he is uniquely qualified to extend forgiveness to us. As the Son of God, Jesus was both fully God, fully man. Therefore, relationally and positionally, there's no one else with the authority to purchase our salvation and forgive our sin. Only Jesus could do that. And when it comes to us forgiving others, Jesus' words and deep love shown are a model for us to follow. Amen. Since we've been greatly forgiven through his blood, we can extend that same mercy, that same love, that same forgiveness to others. Never forget, your sins have been paid for and forgiven. And can I just speak to those of you who routinely feel ashamed or condemned, or maybe you're living in a constant state of rejection or bondage to a certain sin pattern? Could it be that you're living in light of condemnation and not in light of the cross? Believing the lie that your sins are too big to forgive? To walk in the freedom that Christ purchased, it requires that you hold on to the truth of God's word and allow it to renew your heart and your mind. Here's the truth, Romans 8:1. There is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Why? Because Jesus was condemned on our behalf. Jesus' last words left us with an assurance of his love and forgiveness, but also with the confidence that his death has opened the doorway to an eternal relationship with the Father. In verse 43, Jesus is hanging on the cross, dying. In between these two criminals, one of them is yelling out accusations, challenging Jesus on his authority to save himself, while the other criminal turns his gaze toward Jesus and, demonstrating repentance and faith, says, Jesus, remember me when you enter into your kingdom. Family, this criminal seemingly was the least deserving of forgiveness. He actually committed a crime that was deserving of the cross. He didn't even have a reasonable amount of time left in his life for Jesus and this newfound forgiveness to live it out. Yet, in mercy, in love, in compassion, Jesus responds, truly I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise. And I believe this response wasn't only for the criminal. I believe in that moment, he was communicating an eternal hope for all of humanity. Yes. Access. When it comes to gaining access, whether that's getting into your kid's school, especially in DC, going into any government-run workplace, the prerequisite is usually relationship. Who do you know or who knows you before you come in here? It's very rare that you're able to waltz into the White House or an office building without a pass or a person. And Jesus' battered body, shed blood, and personal relationship granted you and me that access to the Father. When Jesus died on that cross, Scripture says that the temple curtain was torn in two, symbolizing that the doorway leading to him was swung wide open. The thief on the cross demonstrates that there's no bad time to turn to Jesus. Amen. When you repent and you believe, he not only remembers you, he welcomes you into his heavenly kingdom. Never forget, access to the Father was purchased for you through Jesus' blood. Hebrews 4:16 says this, let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in time of need. We can approach God with confidence because Jesus has purchased our access to him. Amen. Maybe there's somebody here who has been struggling to connect with God because you think you can't approach him until you clean yourself up. Can I remind you tonight that Jesus' death has already granted you access? The door is wide open. Walk through it. Finally, Jesus' words are a reminder of what's required of you to follow him. What does Jesus require of you? Before he breathed his last breath, in verse 46, he says this, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." There's a story earlier in Luke chapter 2 that tells of Jesus as a 12-year-old boy. And if you blink, you'll miss it, because it doesn't seem like it's a very significant story. But it's Passover, so Mary and Joseph and Jesus go up to Jerusalem for the feast. And when it comes time to return to Nazareth, Mary and Joseph head out unknowingly without their son. How many of you have been there? Don't raise your hand. So, you know, they traveled in large groups, so they just assumed he was around somewhere. But when they get back home, they can't find him. And panicked, as any parent would be, leaving your child in a whole other city, they make a day-long journey back to Jerusalem. And after looking all over for him, they find him in the temple, listening to the teachers and asking really great questions. And Mary, exasperated from the search, asks Jesus this in verse 48, "Son, why have you treated us so bad? Behold, your father and I have been searching for you in great distress." Jesus responds by saying this, "Why were you looking for me? Did you not know that I must be in my father's house?" And some translations say it this way, "Did you not know that I must be about my father's business?" Now, scripture says that Mary and Joseph didn't know what Jesus meant by that. But could it be that Jesus was revealing to his earthly parents that he had come to fulfill the will of his heavenly Father? His purpose was to surrender fully to God. Fast forward 21 years later, it's Passover once again. But this time, instead of bringing a lamb to sacrifice in the temple, Mary watches from afar as her son becomes the sacrificial lamb for the sins of the world. Jesus' last words here aren't a whisper. Scripture says that he called out in a loud voice, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." What was it that Jesus wanted the onlookers to hear and us to grasp from his last words? I believe it's the same heart and message behind what he said as a 12-year-old boy. "I came to surrender, to be about God's business here on earth, to give up my life for the sake of many. This is the work that I'm called to." Never forget that Jesus surrendered to the Father and laid down his life for you. Jesus' greatest act of surrender was out of his great love for you. As he was hanging there on the cross, his thoughts were focused on you. His motivation was to be able to welcome you into his kingdom as a disciple and as a friend. Ask yourself this: is there anything too costly for you to sacrifice out of your love and gratitude for him? Is it too big of a sacrifice to honor him with your time or service? Is sharing your faith with a friend too far for you to go? What about your vision board? Love a good vision board. Are you willing to give up your plan for your life so that you can step into his plan for your life? A life of sacrifice is what you're called to when you choose to follow Jesus. But a life of sacrifice is worth it in light of the sacrifice he made for you and me to be adopted into his family. As I close, what do you need to remember about Jesus' death? First, that your sins have been paid for and forgiven. Second, that access to the Father was purchased for you through his blood. And lastly, Jesus surrendered to the Father and laid down his life for you. So how do we practically live in light of what Jesus did for us on the cross? First, read the story. Read the story. Read your Bible and look for all the ways that each book points to the crescendo of our faith, Jesus. Get in a group of two or three people and study the word together. But don't just read it for head knowledge. Read it for heart transformation. Amen. Second, tell the story. Don't keep the story to yourself. Share this with others. Tell others how your own story is found in this one. Invite someone to come with you on Sunday to our Easter service and let them hear the retelling of the story. Then you go and retell it over and over and over again. And lastly, live out the story. In a moment, we're going to reflect and have a time to do communion together. And it's an opportunity to allow this story to sink down into our hearts. And as you prepare your hearts for this weekend, for Resurrection Sunday, let's rejoice in the work of the cross and allow it to move us forward into the hope and the confidence that our sins have been forgiven and we have been given eternal access to the Father. Amen. Let us never forget, and let's continue to live in light of the cross. Amen. Let's pray. Father, thank you for sending your Son, Jesus, to die on our behalf. Lord, we just thank you. We have no words but just thanks. Our hearts are filled with gratitude for what you've done. And Lord, we pray that you would help us to remember each day the sacrifice that you made, and not just remember, but to model our lives after it. Is there anyone here tonight that would like to give your life to Christ? Maybe you've done it in the past, but you would say now your life doesn't look like what a Christian should look like. Could you raise your hand? I'd like to pray with you. Maybe you online. Father, forgive me. I'm sorry for the way that I've lived. Today, I choose to turn away from my sin and to follow you with all of my heart. Thank you for loving me, and thank you for this free gift of salvation. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. If you prayed that prayer, we would love to connect with you. If you would text GCCCH to 82155, click on the New Life link, and we will give you next steps for how you can walk with the Lord. Amen? Amen. Family, as a way to seal this moment and live out this story, we're going to take communion together and close out our time of worship. Now, this is a little different than what we normally do, but I'm going to read from Matthew chapter 26. Verses 26 to 30. It says, "Now as they were eating, Jesus took bread, and after blessing it, broke it and gave it to the disciples, and said, 'Take, eat. This is my body.' And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, 'Drink of it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink again of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom.'" Communion was instituted by Jesus himself on the night that he was betrayed. And as followers of Jesus, we participate in this sacrament as a way to remember his sacrifice for us on the cross. The bread represents Christ's body that was broken for us, and the juice represents his blood that was shed for us on the cross. And scripture says that we shouldn't come to the communion table in an unworthy manner. So now we're going to take some time to reflect and perhaps repent of anything that we need to. And take all the time that you need to do that. When you're ready, our ushers are going to dismiss row by row, starting in the back. You can join us up front. We have two communion stations. Pastor Mark and Pastor Stephen will lead you in that communion. And feel free to come up individually, or if you would prefer to come up as a family, that's just fine too. But just take a moment to reflect now, and when you're ready, the ushers will invite you to the front to take communion.
Savior, say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all to him. sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Jesus paid. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Jesus paid it all. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow.
I'll stand and sing the last verse. And when before the throne.
And when before the throne I stand in incomplete, Jesus died.
Jesus
died my soul to save. My lips shall still repeat. Jesus paid. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow.
Amen. Father, we thank you for sending your son. Lord, it's old news in the sense that it's thousands of years old, and yet here in this moment it hits us with a freshness that we would be lost without that sacrifice. And so we thank you and we honor you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Can we thank the Lord for how great he is? Amen. Well, my name is Stephen, and I serve as the pastor here, and I also just feel it's fitting to give all the kids a shout out for going through the whole service. I didn't even hear too many. Come on, give it up for the kids, guys, and the parents while we're at it, and the parents. Come on now. You can be seated. If you are new here with us, we want to connect with you. If you text GCCCH to 82155, you can scan that QR code. Our greeters would love to get to know who you are and share a little bit more about the church. And we have a gift especially for you. Also, if you would like to give tonight as an expression of your worship, this isn't primarily for those who are new with us, but if you're a regular here and you would like to give, you can scan that QR code and do that. Guys, I know the parking was a little insane tonight on a Friday night. But Sunday morning, it'll be better in Jesus' name. Amen. I think there was a play happening at the school down the street, so it was a little tight parking-wise. But join us this Sunday, 10 a.m., for our Easter service. This is our Super Bowl as followers of Jesus. So maybe invite somebody who doesn't know Christ, a family member, a friend, and we'll see you here at 10 a.m. Lastly, I want to just read a blessing over you as you stand and as we dismiss. This is Hebrews chapter 13, 11 through 13, and verses 20 and 21. For the bodies of those animals whose blood is brought into the holy places by the high priest as a sacrifice for sin are burned outside the camp. So Jesus also suffered outside the gate in order to sanctify the people through his own blood. Therefore, let us go to him outside the camp and bear the reproach he endured. Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good, that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. 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 Thank you for joining us tonight. If you'd like to break your fast, those of you who are fasting, we're going to go to the Roost down the street, so you're welcome to join us. Have a great Good Friday, and we'll see you on Sunday.